slowly progressive, non-inflammatory ectasic corneal disease, which is the most common corneal ectasia, and it's characterized by changes in the corneal collateral structure and organization, which make it more susceptible to protrusion. The incidence is variable. In some studies, it has been seen that it is more common in South Asians. This again is another classic example of keratoconus with asymmetric bow tie appearance. So, topography which evaluates the anterior corneal surface, most of them based on the zero disc photography, they are the instrument that are still most commonly used for diagnosing keratoconus. Now we also have pentacam. So, pentacam basically is based on shin plug photography, which means that there is a camera which rotates and takes pictures from different angles for the anterior segment, so it gives you a cross section. And the advantage obviously is that it evaluates not only the anterior corneal surface but also the posterior corneal surface, the iris, the anterior chamber angle and other structures. So it is a complete anterior segment reconstruction on the pentacam. Now this is basically a model that is provided in the pentacam machine. What is the advantage of pentacam over topography? That in early some cases of keratoconus, the anterior surface may be completely normal, but the posterior surface may show signs of keratoconus, and these are some cases that may be missed on topography. So here, these are some things that we all must know, because now patients roam around with topography and pentacam maps. So even if you are not doing refractive surgery, we should at least know what these maps are. Now this is a classical Bell and Ambrosio enhanced ectasia display, which is what is used for diagnosing keratoconus. There are other kinds of maps on pentacam. The most commonly we see is the four maps, which can be refractive and other different kind of maps. But for diagnosing ectalic diseases, we use the Bell and Ambrosio display. Now here this shows the front elevation, this shows the back elevation. The difference between topography and this is that it shows elevation in microns as compared to a best fit sphere, which means that if you have a sphere which best approximates the shape of that cornea, then what is the elevation of each point compared to that perfect sphere? So when the cornea is steep, the elevation will be more because it is not a perfect sphere at those points. So if there is more elevation, it is indicative of ectatic disease. So this is the front elevation, this is the back elevation. These maps show basically a map elevation which excludes the steepest 3.5 millimeters of the cornea. So to have a better distinct, the steep 3.5 millimeter area from the cornea is taken away from this analysis, and then another sphere is calculated which is a more better approximation, and then the elevation of the back and the front and the back surface are given, and this gives the difference. And these are the values that are given here. The other things that now come in pentacam are that not only are they doing the surface elevation, but you also have the corneal thickness spatial profile and the percentage thickness increase, which is for the pachymetry. So for keratoconus, because the cornea is very thin at the thinnermost point or at the apex of the cone, there is a sudden increase in the corneal thickness from this thinmost point to the periphery as compared to normal cornea. So these three lines are the average progression of a normal cornea, and this, so basically if this thinnest point is somewhere between 400 and 500 microns here, around 500 microns, and then as we approach the periphery, the thickness increases to about 800 microns or 700 microns, and this shows the progression of the pachymetry from the thinnest point to the periphery. And if these graphs are, it shows a very steep increase, then it is indicative of keratoconus. And then there are many other calculations that are done in these, which is the ART max, which means that the Ambrosio rotational thickness, which basically is divided from the maximum PTI. So all these formulae are given. It is not easy to remember all of them in one go, but it is important to remember that the pentacam gives the front surface as well as the back surface as well as the pachymetry, and then it has these values like the ART max, which is a combination of the pachymetry and the progression from the thinnest to the thickest point. And now there is an enhanced interest in these kind of values, which are also indicative of early keratoconus, not just the elevation marks. Now this is another classical pentacam where the anterior surface is normal, the posterior surface shows some degree of ectasia, and therefore this is suggestive of keratoconus. And so it will show these red flags or yellow flags, and these all are very easy to read with time. Now this is an interesting case. If you see a topography like this, there is a lot of steepening here. The Topography says it is keratoconus. What would you all type of? So it looks very steep, it looks all red, but it is not classical of keratoconus. This is the left eye and this is the right eye. So as you can see, this looks all red. This shows keratoconus mounting topography as per machine analysis. This is the right eye of the same patient, but this shows normal. So here when you do a pentacam, this is the left eye which was the more red eye, and this is the other eye. These are all normal. Even though the cornea is very steep, it's 51 and 52 diopters, but this shows normal. So this basically, now these are some rare problems where if you look carefully, this is a crab claw sign which is shown in classically in pellucid marginal degeneration. So here you can see that this is not really an inferior steepening. The inferior area this shows yellow, and this is more of a horizontal steepening. So this is these are some of the things that one can encounter at times, and when you do post topography and pentacam and it shows atypical patterns, we can diagnose these rare diseases also. Of course, the from the management point of view, the main difference would be explaining the prognosis to the patient. So these are some of the more interesting cases. And the most important thing in these cases is to, for when you are evaluating candidates for refractive surgery. So here, now, then there can be errors in diagnosis when you have a patient who is wearing contact lenses, because this can sometimes simulate a keratoconus-like pattern. The anterior surface can show problems because of dry eyes, and which causes localized dry spots, so there will be errors in diagnosis. If for some reason the inferior area is very tight, there is some pressure of the inferior cornea, that can also cause problems in diagnosis. And sometimes early keratoconus which show high center, it can be misdiagnosis, meridional amblyopia and into high center. These are the other aesthetic disorders which we need to keep in mind. Keratoconus, pellucid marginal degeneration are not very common. The management basically is that you can use contact lenses of different type, even soft toric contact lenses, RGB lenses, hybrid lenses, low scale, scleral, supermount, piggyback. These are all types of contact lenses that are used in keratoconus. Ribosomal assisted collagen cross-linking is a way to stop the progression of keratoconus, especially if you see a young patient or if there is documented progression of keratoconus. Intacs are basically intrastromal corneal ring segments for low degrees of myopia associated with keratoconus. Various types of toric IOLs, IPCLs, which can be used in stable keratoconus cases. So if we are sure that the keratoconus is stable over a period of time, or if in the early age group we are operating on a case of cataract with keratoconus, then we can use toric IOLs, etc., so that these ventricular infraction is also taken care of. And various kinds of lamellar and full thickness corneal surgeries are used for more advanced cases. Penetrating keratoplasty is now reserved for keratoconus with corneal scarring, which cannot be probably cured by the lamellar surgeries. This is an article from IGO by Dr. Rohit Shetty and all, who do a lot of work on keratoconus. They have devised some sort of a high risk characteristic table for progression, as per which they decide on the management. So obviously, age is young, there is a very high risk of progression. Eye rubbing, even though cause and effect is not established, but if there is a history of eye rubbing, the progression is faster, and frequent change of glasses are the examined things. But the most important thing is to remember is young age. These are various kinds of corneal surgeries which are used. It's more like an alphabet soup, but basically penetrating keratoplasty, which is used, which was used from the earlier days. This is deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty. This is desmoid membrane endothelial keratoplasty. This is deep stromal automated keratoplasty. Of course, this is not for keratoconus. This is just types of corneal surgeries. So keratoprosthesis is not used for keratoconus. These are the different kind of contact lenses that are available. These are some of the proprietary names. There are soft K, these are soft contact lenses, rose K, super, then scleral contact lenses, which are basically large diameter contact lenses. And these are all used for keratoconus cases, but you need to refer them to a specialized center which deals with this kind of contact lens fitting. Now, C3I, which has come up in a big way in the last few years, this was research done by Professor Theo Seeger, and basically Professor Theo Seeger had seen this at a dentist place where he was using the UV light and microfilm for some filling material. So So from there we got the idea if that film layer can be hardened by this process, it can probably be used in Keratoconus also to stiffen the cornea. And basically what is done is that you use riboflavin, which is a photosensitizer, and then you expose this riboflavin exposed cornea to UV light of around 360 nanometers at 3 milliwatts. So this is a small video. This is the case of Keratoconus. This is the pentagram which shows classical and linear as well as posterior surface elevation problems. So you you take a vexel and you put some alcohol. There are different techniques for removing the epithelium, but alcohol, 20% alcohol for 20 seconds is what is used most widely. And you put this in this 8mm well that is used for photorefractive keratectomy, that is PRK refractive surgery also. And then you use any blunt instrument because the epithelium is now loose, so you use any blunt instrument to remove the epithelium from that center 8mm. And ideally you should see the position of the cone preoperatively so that you cover the area of the cone. And then you apply riboflavin solution to the cornea. You can use isotonic riboflavin if the cornea thickness is more than 400 microns. Ideally this 400 microns should be after removal of the epithelium. But as an approximation, any cornea above 400 microns, we can use isotonic riboflavin. And then this is the CPR machine. So for 30 minutes, you put, this is the classical Dresden protocol, which is the one most commonly used. You put riboflavin every 2 minutes for about 30 minutes, and then you expose it to the UV light for another 30 minutes, and keep putting riboflavin drop by drop every 5 minutes. At the end of the procedure, you put a bandage contact lens because you have removed the epithelium. And the post-op treatment would include bandage contact lens for symptomatic relief, antibiotic and steroid eye drops. You have to give something for pain relief because it is a de-epithelialized cornea, so it would be very irritable. And watch for corneal haze as well as corneal edema, which has been observed in many cases after C3R, but it is temporary and normally resolves. This is Intacs. Basically, these are intrastromal corneal ring segments. The principle is that you have, if you have a protrusion like this and you expand at the sides, then the top becomes flat. So this was something that was used earlier for low degrees of myopia, but now it is approved for keratoconus, and this can help in the keratoconus. Now these are various algorithms that are given for management of keratoconus. You can have joint carriers and all these. The thing to add corneal surgeries depending on the thickness of the cornea, but the thing to remember is that CTR is to stabilize the keratoconus, and we must do it for those who come at a young age and show documented progression so that the progression is slowed down. And then after CTR, in some cases we can also combine it with a refractive surgery. So there is something called CTR with PRK for those cases which are also desirous of getting rid of glasses and where the thickness of the cornea is adequate for refractive surgery, or for those cases who have ectasia after LASIK, you can do CPR combined with PRK.